We have one more gift to end our 3 days together. As Trish and Sonia and I thought really hard about what do we do with all the chunks of time over 3 days with a group, there's a lot of things that are on the list. Also, with it being the middle of August, this is a busy time for everyone in the room. So we thought, how might we be able to leave the space here in Traverse City in a really great way, both physically and mentally, to be able to enter back at home base into the school year. So it led us to think, who could we bring in that could help the group think about the big picture and have some ways to leave here in a positive way. So we invited Paul Liebenau, who's the executive director at MEMSPA, who is a great partner of our work. Paul's an ally and an advocate of our work for kids in Michigan. He supports educators across the state, specifically middle and elementary principals, through his main role and probably many others. We're excited to have him here to lead us and close out our 3 days together. In addition, we have Dino Rochelo, who is a curriculum director at Glen Lake, to add to the story. So without further ado, give a round of applause for Paul and Dina as we close.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for hanging out, because you must be present to win. So I run conferences two or three a year, and invariably 20% of the population leaves, sometimes 25%. Well, that's not true the last 2 years, as I was sharing with the Mesa staff. But we have some cool MEMSPA swag at the back table, and we'll be raffling that off, including a nice gift box from one of my favorite places, Cherry Republic. But you have to be present to win. So it's a delight to be here. I honor your work. I thank you for the work that you're doing. I'm a math major, science and math. I graduated before many of you were born from Michigan State University. I worked with Northwestern, have a degree from Michigan State, Central, Northwestern, and I did some graduate work at the University of Michigan. I've been in K-12 now for just about 42 years, 32 years in K-12, and I'm in year 12 at MEMSPA, teacher, principal, and superintendent for roughly a decade. And so there's a level of urgency around math instruction that I think the general public doesn't recognize. I do work in different parts of the world, South Korea, Japan, UAE in the Middle East, Nepal, and I see what's going on in other countries, and I have a little bit of context from two of my children. One is a West Point grad, and the other is, which I'll talk about later, who I will speak about later, is a lieutenant colonel and a fighter pilot, and he talks to me a lot about education. I've met with generals and heads of state to have conversations about how we're underperforming in mathematics specifically, but I give them hope because of the people in this room. Right, you are what I would call the last best hope for our country as it relates to being at the top of the heap as we compete with the likes of China, Russia, and India. But first, I just want to give you a little bit of do we have a slide advance? Okay. Yeah, go to the next slide. So, just a little bit of context. We celebrated my dad's 91st birthday last November. He's an exceptional, hardworking laborer who worked two jobs raising myself and my three brothers. His father, my grandfather, who is an engineer, died at age 38 from Hodgkin's disease and left a family of eight penniless. My dad went to work at age 11 delivering milk in Detroit with only a fifth grade education at that point. He got a driver's license, a permit at age 14 to drive a milk truck delivering milk door to door. He was sort of the epitome of resilience. He's 91 years old. He still fills the firewood burner. He's still on the family farm and kind of an amazing person. I have a lot of respect for my dad and honor him. He is completely deaf and has lost nearly all of his vision. Doesn't get out much. So when he does get out, it's a big deal. So I took him to Denny's for breakfast. Many of you may have passed Denny's on the way into the resort. He was really happy to go out to eat. He hadn't been out much. He's deaf as a result of a forestry accident when he was in his late 20s. And so we ordered. We sat down and ordered. He was really excited about having a meal that he didn't cook. It didn't turn out well, though. The scrambled eggs were runny, the coffee was cold, and the toast was burned. And I could hear him grumbling. I could hear him grumbling about it. And I said, "Dad, I know it's not exactly what you expected, but be nice." So we finished the meal and stepped up to the counter to pay. I pulled out my credit card, and the attendant said, "Well, how was your breakfast?" And he said, "Compliments to the photographer." Yeah, I know it's late, but come on, folks. So, as I said, it's good to be here with you, but I want to talk to you about, not math, about your personal wellness. I do work with the Center for Education Improvement in Washington, D.C. The center focuses on leader wellness. Actually, I just stepped down as president after 6 years and still serve as a board member. We're working with Yale University and doing a lot of research in the space around leader wellness. You've heard that. I mean, you've heard about it a little bit here at this conference. But why it's important to me is because I want you to be in your jobs into your 30th and 35th year of your career and not wanting to leave when you're 5 years in. Burnout. Burnout is a thing. It's a bigger thing than it was even a decade ago. And I know you will agree, it's sort of an imperative that we recognize the needs of the teachers that you serve, the people that you're providing training for, professional development, and so on. What we often miss in the equation, however, is that addressing the very real and weighty demands of you in your position, like expectations of senior staff at your ISD, school board expectations, district test scores, and initiatives, they're all on your plate, directly or indirectly. According to the State of American Teacher and State of the American Principal surveys by Rand Corporation, twice as many teachers and principals reported experiencing job-related stress as the general population of working adults in 2022. 85% of principals reported frequent job-related stress, and nearly half reported as experiencing burnout. I imagine one or two of you in the room fit in the category. I won't ask you to show hands, but think about it. Have you ever fantasized about, at the end of a really tough day, about running away, leaving, going to a different job? Well, that's sort of what I've dealt with over the course of the last several years. Principal John, a guy called me at 8 o'clock on Sunday night. He said, "I need an exit plan, Paul. I cannot go to work tomorrow. I've had enough. I'm exhausted. My wife is angry with me. I never see my kids because I'm always working. Two parents, three teachers, they want me gone. The superintendent says my school may have a culture climate problem. I'm the fifth principal in this school in the past 7 years and inherited some dysfunction, but I can't seem to fix it. What's more is I've had a highly effective for the past 15 years. Not a blemish on my record. But this year's different. I think I've lost hope." Hey, by the way, the parent survey and the teacher survey last spring rated me 9 out of 10 effective. That's a thing. So I'm quitting and going to a 9-to-5 job. He did. 2 weeks later, he resigned. 2 days before Christmas, he's working happily, as he tells me, in a 9-to-5 job, spending time with his kids and his wife. But that was a choice he made. We represent 1,300 school principals across the state of Michigan, and 98% of them are having success. They figured it out, how to manage life and work. And I'm hoping that you're doing the same, because it can be a problem. So expert in leadership development, Jim Davis, is quoted as saying, leading well depends on the wellness of the leader. For many of you, your daily work is focused on the wellness of everybody else, the people you're serving, not yourselves. In fact, there seems to be so little time to complete your already full task list, adding space for wellness seems a bit odd and another obligation. So I'd invite you to think for a moment to embrace a shift in perspective. Wellness not as exercises or activities, but as a larger concept, wellness as personal balance and wholeness with multiple dimensions of health. A decade ago, I would never have talked about these subjects because I grew up in a different space where we were all told to figure it out. Pull up your boots, pull up your pants, grow up, you'll figure it out. Times have changed because people are leaving and we need them desperately. Teachers and principals are leaving the profession and we need them desperately. I know you hear self-awareness referenced in every professional development session your district facilitates, and there's a reason. It is perhaps the most important foundational element because without it, you don't know where to start. You won't be able to assess your well-being in the dimensions we just talked about, and you certainly won't be able to identify what you need. When stress becomes chronic and toxic, we feel stuck in chaos. We have trouble understanding what is happening in the moment and when we need self-awareness to find a solution. Thinking back to Principal John, he was in a state of acute crisis. He just needed it to stop. He couldn't find the space to problem solve or to be curious about what other options might be available to him. He was depleted in many of his dimensions: physical exhaustion, emotional overwhelm, relational conflict. Understandable, right? Yeah, reactive, yes, but ideal, no. In the new book, From Burnout to Fired Up, Reigniting Your Passion for Teaching, author Morgan Michael proposes a 5 R's framework to counter burnout. Pairing this with the lens of curiosity we talked about moves our theory of a whole leader into practice. The 3 R's, or I should say these R's, mirror the 5 core competencies of SEL and by Castle, which might be a way to further support SEL work in your district that you're already engaged in. Morgan Michael's 5 R's, let's consider my friend Principal John as a review, as we review them. Reflect. First, we reflect. Reflect. Think about where you're at. Reframe your inner narratives in a way that helps you to rebound. So you're going into a school year now. You're fired up. But around November, December, it may not feel as you may not feel as energized and as happy. So think about reframing, reflect, thinking about your emotions and your general state of mind. And then reframe. To develop resilience, we have to reframe our inner narratives in a way that helps us rebound. We've been through some serious chaos in my family: death from suicide and cancer. We've had a lot of challenges over time in our family, less so in my work. My work has been sort of that solace place for me. But I had to reframe many times in my life over the course of the last 42 years of my career to think differently. Thinking differently, by that I mean think about what you can control. Invite a growth mindset. Thinking about from I'm exhausted, I can't, to what would make me feel rested so I can start again. Moving from I'm failing miserably to positive change takes time. I feel that way about the work in math. I've been watching our math scores drop over the course of the last two decades. In the legislature, I'm also a lobbyist. I have a paid lobbyist, but I'm also a lobbyist. And I talk to legislators about our math scores regularly. And I say, well, what's the problem? I said, it didn't take 2 years to get to where we are. We can't fix it in 2 years. We've been at this for 20 years. It's going to take some time to get to the top of the heap, to be number one or two or three in the country again. We need time. Positive change takes time. And then refocus. To overcome the purposelessness that often comes with burnout, we need to learn to refocus our dreams and goals so that we can live the personal and professional lives that we'd hoped for. And then reconnect. I'm going to talk about boundaries in a minute too, but reconnect. Humans are wired, they're wired to connect, so finding ways to connect with others will help stop a burnout. I recommend that you find two or three people that, and many of you probably already have done so, connecting with friends. You might have a drink with them on Friday night. You need a place to vent. Later in my career as superintendent, I pulled four different friends around me and I met with them monthly. I called them my personal board of directors. They gave me advice about my work in the community, my participation in activities, and helped me to maintain balance. They gave me wise counsel. Find those people in your life and schedule that time into your month. Principal John didn't. He felt isolated and disenfranchised. Reveal. Our well-being suffers when we don't have an avenue to express ourselves. John was so wrapped up in work, he gave up golf. He liked to play golf. He and his wife used to go dancing. They canned that. Spent time with their kids when he wasn't working. So I want to leave you with a few necessary practices toward the end for all leaders, regardless of your unique formula for personal life balance. But first, let's go. My friend Dina Rocholo is here with me, in part because she was my backup. I had RSV about 4.5 weeks ago, and I'm on every possible medication known to mankind. I've had to speak 2 or 3 times since that time. And really wanted, this is really important for me to be here, because you're really important to me. The level of urgency around this work, I said earlier, is really, really important to me. I want my grandchildren, all 8 of them, to be able to be schooled in a public school. I don't want to send them to a private school. Never. I believe in public ed. And you are the leaders that are going to make that difference in math. If you need help in your district with your superintendent or your primary, whoever's evaluating you and you want to step out and forge ahead, call on me. I'll carry some water for you. I'm happy to put your boss in a chokehold. No, that's a violation of our SEL practices. I'm sorry. You get the point. Dina Rocholo, curriculum director and expert, resident expert in SEL.
I'm the middle school principal. Hi, everyone. My name is Dina, and before I moved to Glen Lake, I was the assistant superintendent of curriculum and instruction at Ferndale Schools for a long time, and I was the elementary principal at Roosevelt Primary. And they had 4 principals in 4 years, and they were failing in the eyes of the state. We never changed an instructional practice, but we did change how we felt about ourselves and in turn changed what we felt about our children, and we became a national school of character and because we felt better about ourselves. So I'm going to share some practices today. But before we do that, these are my children. Oh, what happened? There they are. None of them went to schools, and none of them are fighters. I'm lucky to get the little one to school, and one of his teachers is right there, and she's going, yep. Right? Yeah. You're lucky he's in 6th grade. The little one is Dawson. He's going into 6th grade. He's in OOPS. And 17 years earlier, I had the one, the blonde on top. She's 28. And when I was about 22, 23 years old, this little boy on the left, his name is Brian McGeehee. Well, I fell in love with Brian when I was a kindergarten teacher of varying exceptionalities in Florida. That means any child they don't know what to do with, they gave to Dina. Brian was born addicted to crack cocaine and with cerebral palsy. He had a temper tantrum about every 10 seconds, and so they kept him with me for about 6 years. And I loved him, and I took guardianship of him. He turned 37 yesterday. He's a great kid. And the reason I show him that, I thought there was a better way. I thought there was a better way to support children, all children, instead of what we were doing. And so before social emotional learning was even a thing, I was like, we got to do better for our children. And so that's where this journey began. So let's go on and think about a few things. Think about this quote. I want you to think about it in a different lens. We have lots of different educators here. We have ISD consultants, we have principals, we have educators in the classroom, so many different people. Okay, I'm short. So, it is difficult to give children a sense of security unless you have it yourself. If you have it, they catch it from you. And think about it, many of you work with adults. It is difficult to give adults a sense of security unless you have it yourself. So think about it in the lens of a parent, a child, a custodian, central office, a secretary, whoever you may encounter. We know that's true. Paul talked about the unpredictability. How many of you principals are still looking at hiring somebody within the next week or so? Lots. And so all of those unpredictability things that are taking place right now. Today we're going to talk about our adult well-being. Every moment matters to us. And so we're going to talk about some work that Paul has done with our dear friend Carla. And we're going to talk about and go into the Collective Well-Being Project. But as educators, we need to learn more about how do we foster well-being and prevent burnout for all of us. So there's some three things that we're going to do, and we're going to go into those those handouts that are on your table. But we can prevent burnout by doing some things, but we're not going to just do things. Like you guys said, you're going to reframe professional development. So what you're saying is you want to put more intentionality into how you think about professional development. You want to have more intentionality on how do you have teacher-to-teacher conversations. You want more intentionality on how to bring collaboration with your staff, or more intentionality when you bring staff to your ISD or when you go out to your buildings. That word intentionality is so important. So with burnout, we need to be intentional. Intentional on how we gather staff together. It needs to be systemic, just like we are when we are in our classroom. And all of us here have been in a classroom before. We need to be able to listen with respect. Those are words that our students hear every day. Listening with respect. Be present where your feet are. Safety lies in the moment. Think about that. How many of you experience anxiety within your families, within the children you work with, within the students or the staff or the families? It's because they don't know how to be present in the moment, because our society doesn't. How many of you have gone to Target and seen the darn Halloween stuff already? No matter, that's why we have anxiety, because we're already thinking about what kind of costume to have at the end of October. Let's just stick with the back to school section right now, right? And if you go to Hobby Lobby, they have Christmas. Be present where your feet are. And any of you have a book called Be Present Where Your Feet Are? If you don't have it, it's incredible. It's written really for anybody in upper elementary or middle school. Oh, where did that go? Design for the margins. Oh, you guys are math people. I am not. My math teachers would be amazed that I'm here. But quadrant, right? You know that quadrant, the high and low and all that. The margins, those people that are up here and down here, design what you're going to do to get those outliers. Not everyone likes the same thing. And that's what we really need to think about. And anchor your student and staff in the decisions that you make. If you're not aware of something called Class Catalyst, Paul and I can talk to you afterwards. It's really for students. It's really, really incredible. And leveraging the collective well-being. So if you can get out those handouts that we shared with you. But today I want us to think about our nervous system and our well-being. There are three conditions that our nervous system just can't take. So I want you just to think about our schools and our district right now. Unpredictability. Think about what Paul just shared. Isolation. Some of you out there do feel like you're on an island. I have felt like I've been on an island before. And Paul knows that. When Paul says he'll give you your phone number, you better believe he answers. I've been on an island. I've had trauma. When I was a new principal, I had a 5-year-old die in my arms. You want to talk about trauma? I knew Paul would be there. And was he there? And who kept checking on me? Paul. That's trauma. Physical and emotional restraint. We have a lot of kids that don't have restraint to say what they think about you. We have a lot of families that have no restraint to tell you what they think about you, Mrs. R. They don't even have restraint not to share it on Facebook. It's always nice to wake up to see what they think. But here's what we can do. We're so resilient. We can provide routines. Routines are the skeleton. They are the skeleton of your ISD. They are the skeletons of your work. They are the skeletons of your school. They are the skeleton of our districts. Rituals are the heart, and they're a big difference. Predictability. How many of you have planned a vacation to Disney World and you woke up and told your kids and they just had a meltdown? Because that's not predictable. Warm structure, not military-like. It's okay to be assertive and be kind at the same time. And it's okay to tell staff why you're doing that and that you don't have to be mean to say what you mean and mean what you say. And connections. Paul mentioned this too. But connections on the outside build neuro connections on the inside at all ages. From the second trimester of pregnancy until we pass away, that connections on the outside build neuro connections right here. And we need a sense of belonging. We need a sense of belonging. So Paul's going to talk about this, and then we're going to go into deeper and think about some ideas on the paper.
So we've had the opportunity to work with the Surgeon General to essentially put an educational lens on their thinking around social-emotional learning and adult well-being. Focusing on protection from harm, connection and community, work-life harmony, mattering at work, and opportunity for growth. Dina, go to the next slide. We have, in partnership with the University of Chicago, Chapin Hall, and Mindful Practices, developed open source resources to prevent burnout and staff retention. So with your phone, go to this QR code. It'll take you to the site with a plethora of resources, and they're easy to use. and they're built to fit for you and your work. Take just 60 seconds to peruse that site. Our work with Castle and Mindful Practices in Chicago, as well as the University of Chicago, has led to some major changes in teacher training, teacher professional development, administrator and leader professional development. It has clearly changed the culture and climate of schools, reducing student attrition, that is students and families leaving the district. It's reduced students being sent to the office, increased parent satisfaction with the school. And it's all about social emotional intelligence and applying the pure science to our work.
On your tables, you do have the mindful practices. If you look at the one that says collective well-being on the left, and then it has the current priorities for the U.S. Surgeon General, you can see that it has essential on the left, and then components and programming outcomes. And when you go back to schools, you can think about that. Principals and ISDs, your staff handbook. One of the things that I did this summer was really go through our staff handbook, and I really did some big changes to that. So if that's something you're interested in, I'd be more than willing to share that with you. But what we'd like for you to do right now at your table groups, and I know some of you only have two or one, but maybe you could get together, is we're going to start with this climate and culture guide with the four boxes. And I want you to think about, what do you do in your role with the staff members that you have in regards to collective well-being? And think about it this way. Do you have trusting connections and a sense of safety or a sense of belonging? And what do you do to maintain that? So take a few minutes in your group to talk about that, and then we'll come back together in about a minute and a half, 2 minutes. Collective well-being, and you could look on the back for some ideas that might fall under that. So collective well-being of your group that you work with the most. And we'll come back together in about 20 seconds. And 10, 8, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Who wants to share something exciting? Because we like to borrow with honor in education. We don't steal ideas. We just borrow with honor, right? And that's important. So, who wants to share something super cool you do for collective well-being where you're at? Come on, I know there's super cool ideas. Oh, we got something back there.
So I'll go ahead and start. Rusty just named tomorrow as being a mani-pedi day for me and Sonia. So, talk about well-being. Who else?
We said laughing, giggling, smiling.
And did you know laughter boosts your immune system to up to 2 to 3 days after? Listen, guys, laughter boosts your immune system for up to 2 to 3 days. Think about that. When you're with your students, when you're with your adults, when you're with your family, laughter is good for your health. I see someone else's hand.
So my principal was new last year, and she brought with her the idea of workout Wednesdays. Ooh. So we're allowed to wear workout gear to school on Wednesdays, and she encourages us to have our students move more throughout the day and intentionally plan that, but also for us, if we want to work out together after school, people can.
Nice. Like, do you guys, I know I'm old, but does anyone wear, like, 80s stuff, like in really cute, like bright pink and fluorescent stuff? I like that. Sarah Jane would do that too, wouldn't you? You would like, yeah, yeah, all that. All right, anyone else for collective well-being? All right, this is the hardest one, individual self-care. So I want you to think about this question before you talk with your group. This is hard, and I want you to be honest, because when I asked this question to myself, I didn't have an answer. Do you have 3 to 4 regulatory practices for in the moment when someone pushes your button or triggers you? Do you have 3 to 4 regulatory practices? Meaning, do you turn around and take a deep breath? At home, you can run into the bathroom and lock the door, but you can't do that at work. So think about that and talk about with your table mates, what do you do to lead with this concept in mind, and how do you model that for the people you work around or the students you work around? Again, 2 minutes. All right, 20 more seconds. We'll come together in 10, 8, 6, 3, 2, 1. Who out there wants to share something that is important to them to take care of themselves? This is something I think some of us find really hard to do. So I saw somebody in a beautiful green sweater back there, or shirt.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. I think people think I'm odd when I'm in stores, but when I see something like so adorable, I'm always like, that is so beautiful. I think it's gorgeous.
That's really, I'm done. I don't have to say anything. Just kidding. I really do. So my first thing is I pray in my head, and I normally just say Jesus, because that name settles me. But I really do this. I write and rip. So a lot of times I go back, and on a sticky, I have them everywhere, and I write what I'm really thinking, and then I rip it up and I throw it out. And then about 2 years ago, I started doing the Be Generous in My Thoughts. I don't want to cry again. I'm not going to. But, you know, I had homeless kids. I had kids milking cows at 2 a.m. I didn't get that world.
Yeah.
And so behavior, right, is communication. And just to keep that mindfulness that my battle is not with that human being. That's not where the battle lies. And I'm not going to engage in it.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. Let's give her a round of applause. Yeah. Is your name Heidi? Heidi, remember this. What we offer others, we strengthen in ourselves. Okay? What we offer others, we strengthen in ourselves. So thank you. Saturday, I went up to the UP because a young man that I have in my high school didn't want to come home, but he said if my second mom went and got him, he'd come home. And I went and got him. So we do what we do because we love and we care. So thank you. All right. We're not going to take time about staff appreciation and communications, but I want to share a few things. When we think about staff and teacher appreciation, it takes all of us. So two words that I think are important for all of us is I notice. I've always used this with kids, and I've always taught children with some pretty big emotional needs or physical, like children with special needs. So I started with, oh, Brian, I see your fist is up in the air. Put it down. Brian, I notice you're about to run out of the room. Stop your feet. But it works the other way. Heidi, I notice you're trying so hard today. What can I do to support you? Heidi, I notice you're about to cry. Can I take over your class? Right? Paul, I notice you're working so hard. Can I do this for you? I notice for kids, adults, and families. Families need this too. So, and not everyone likes the same things. I've already talked about rituals, but at Glen Lake, we started something called Thankful Thursday. And anything that students can make, we use. So our signs at the middle school and high school and things that we use, our kids make. So this is Thankful Thursday. It's systemic from pre-K to 12. On Thursday, teachers and staff, educators, everyone fills out a card on something that they noticed about somebody else. Operations, bus drivers, and they put it in their mailbox. Another thing that we do is this box. I don't have a cute name for it, but someone's probably more creative than me. So every month I ask teachers to put something in this box. And at the end of the year during evaluation, this is what we go through first. Because every month something special happens. But what do? We always forget the good things. This is from one of my teachers. Hey, Dina, be your hero. You have a lot of challenges, and you are being your own hero, and I notice you. I hope you could continue to get the answers you need. We are here for you. And other things from my staff, cards that I've gotten, things that I got from MIMSPA. That's my memories from last year. That's what I start my evaluations with. You think the tone of the evaluations go different? Yeah, ISD consultants, think about how you could do that. Everyone could do this with the group of people that they have in different ways. So I'm going to end on saying, what you focus on, you get more of. Can we go back to the slides? Oh. So I'm not going to go into here, but I want to show you a few things that all of you can use, and we'll make sure you have this. That staff anchor survey is something that I'll be sharing with my staff on the first day. It asks them to tell me what they need from me, because everyone's needs are a little different. I'm always asking students what they need. I just had this epiphany, like, shouldn't I be asking staff? Because they all need something a little different. Some people need a hug. I'm a hugger, I'll hug anyone. But I know there's some people in my staff are like, oh God, here she comes, I'm hiding. And I need to recognize that. So I'm asking them, what can I do when they're dysregulated? Because teachers get dysregulated, and we need to recognize that. And then the first 6 weeks of staff survey, let's see how we're doing collectively, because we know collective efficacy is a bigger predictor of student success than free and reduced lunch and all sorts of things. So you are more than welcome to email me for that. They're nothing fancy. This is a little menu that says, hey, what can I do for you? Your PTA? Here's a good way for them to support staff. And then my final thought is, what if you, in any position you had, started with your families, your students, your staff, and you started the year by saying, share with me, what does safety look like to you? And maybe you ask yourself, what does it feel like to you? What can you hear and see when you feel safe? What do you need to feel safe in a classroom, inside of a relationship, or within an environment? What cues your body to feel safe? Hey, mathematicians, math teachers, what if you asked your math teachers to start the year in their math classes asking their math students from calculus to pre-K? Because I've heard math anxiety is a real thing, says the non-math human. Right? Think about that in the lens of all sorts of different people. If we just started by asking that. And last but not least from me, look at this picture. I want you to remember as you walk away today that the most important 12 inches in education are between your brain and your heart. I think I got that from the heartmathinstitute.org. And with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Paul.
So in closing, I want you to think about three words, particularly boundaries, rest, and gratitude. Boundaries, if you remember nothing from this hour, remember boundaries, rest, and gratitude. So how much sleep are you getting each night? Centers for Disease Control and Prevention recommend 7 to 9 hours. Raise your hand if you're getting 8 hours of sleep. Raise your hand if you're getting 9 hours of sleep. Raise your hand if you're getting 7 hours of sleep. How about 5 hours? Shame on you. So I used to wear as a badge of honor that I was a workaholic and that I slept 4 to 5 hours a night. I'm 66 years old now. I've been to the doctor. Cardiologist says my heart's in great shape. He said it's roughly that of a 30-year-old. That's good news for me. But he said, you have to get more sleep. So my goal in life right now, because I want to live to be 91 like my dad, is to get rest. And of those of you who are at 5 hours, thanks for your dedication to your family and work, but knock it off. You need more sleep. It's an absolute. Your physical wellness and your mental wellness will get better and better with more sleep. And quite frankly, you will live longer. You also have to set boundaries. And I fail at that, quite frankly, because I get calls on Sunday. Of the week, I take time off for church in the morning. So I turn my phone off at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning, and it's back on at 1 o'clock after church. Otherwise, I take calls from 7 a.m. until 11 p.m. It used to be 6 a.m. to midnight. I changed that because I was waking up my wife. When someone's in desperation and they open an email and they've been told they're put on administrative leave, they're in a panic. And they need to talk to someone that will talk them off the ledge. I answer the phone call and work them through it. But I have changed my parameters, and I hope you put boundaries in your life in terms of how you connect with your staff and those you're working with. But back to rest, I'd like you to think about this as an experiment. This Saturday night, you know, many of you have already started your work in your ISD or your district. I encourage you to turn off the TV and screens, read something inspirational, and go to bed early. And I say early, 10 o'clock, 10 p.m., even 9 o'clock. Try that. Turn on some rain music, or something I put on every night is night sounds. It's actually crickets chirping. And for the first couple of weeks, I made my wife crazy, but now we're used to it. And it helps us go to sleep and sleep through the night. One of the simplest practices to cultivating greater happiness is gratitude. Positive psychology research shows a practice of gratitude helps people feel more positive, embrace good experiences, and improve their health and relationships. This practice slows down some of the frenetic energy of demands of your to-do list. It connects us back to the things that are most important to us. Several ways to incorporate gratitude practice into your life. Start with a gratitude journal. I use my iPhone notes, and every morning I start with identifying gratitude. What am I thankful for? I've had this RSV. I've been coughing for 3 weeks, like nonstop. I've had every medication that you can imagine. I felt better at the end of the day yesterday. What do you think I put in my gratitude list this morning? Recovering from RSV. I'm thankful for that. People have died at my age with RSV. I'm not going anytime soon. Gratitude. I bought a gratitude journal for each of my grandchildren. I have two grandchildren in Ireland, and sent them gratitude journals. I want them to practice gratitude, being thankful for the good things in their life. And I want to emphasize an imperative, and that's boundaries. As I mentioned before, Principal John didn't set boundaries, and he was pummeled constantly with emails and phone calls. I have to point out the obvious. Even with few boundaries, John wasn't getting everything completed because he was overwhelmed with overworking and over-worrying. Fear is the other thing that crushes us. Fear of the unknown. Fear of tomorrow. We have to control that, and we can do that with practicing gratitude. A good way to embody the practice of boundaries, by the way, is to spread the permission among your school communities. Walk the talk. Show your teachers it's okay, or your peers, that it's okay not to answer emails over the weekend by not sending them. Encourage the people that you work with to celebrate all aspects of their whole lives, not just academic. Begin to prioritize the things that make you whole and protect them at all costs. A little help back there. So rest, gratitude, and boundaries. So I'm going to get a little more personal. This is my son, who's a pilot, and his wife, Jenny. She's a JAG attorney. And they tried with IVF for 7 years to get pregnant. 7 years. And they were all over the world. UAE, Qatar, South Korea. They landed in South Korea for a 2-year tour, and an incredible team of doctors in South Korea helped them get pregnant. My son wanted a child in the worst possible way. He agonized wanting a child. And I've never seen anyone more grateful than my son with that now two-year-old child sitting in front of them. They're grateful and we're grateful. But that long haul was misery. I'm talking about a grown man, 39 years old, a fighter pilot, 2 tours in Afghanistan, crying like a baby because he wanted a child so badly. We call this child the miracle baby, Michael Paul. Gratitude. We're really, really thankful. And this is my other son, Jordan. He's grateful. His wife left him 4 years ago with those children and hasn't been back since. Now 4.5 years ago. That was trauma for him and our family. We took care of those children, took them in with gratitude. We were thankful we had the opportunity to spend time with them and protect them. He's remarried and he said, "Dad, I never knew I could be so happy." He's grateful and thankful through trauma. And lastly, I'm not sharing a picture of my son. My oldest biological child is 40 years old. He has Asperger's. He has 138 IQ. He's a manic depressive. He's been incarcerated 12 different times for drunk and disorderly. And as I share with audiences, I've been sitting next to my child 12 different times while I saw him go to jail for as many as 9 months to a year. Agony. He's a recovering alcoholic, an addict. For the first time in 20 years, for the first time in 20 years, he's 3 months dry. And then there's somebody in this room, there always is, that has faced some challenges, maybe not with your immediate family, but with a family member. And we need to give them hope. We need to give them hope. My son is dating a clinical psychologist. Go figure. And she is keeping him in tow. He's brilliant. He's made boatloads of cash. As I was sharing with Brian last year, he made $1.3 million, but spent it all on drugs and alcohol. He's recovered now, and he's headed to Africa. In his world, he works in pharmaceuticals, again, go figure, and delivering medications for malaria and AIDS in different parts of Africa. That's amazing, what a parent could hope for. Nothing more. But I'm grateful. Are you grateful for those things that are happening in your life that seem like they're never going to end, those sort of horrific things? Have you lost hope? If you have, I encourage you to think about and hope for something better, because it will land. It will land. I can tell you 20 years of waking up at 2 a.m. in the morning, listening to a sheriff's deputy say, "We're incarcerating your son. At some point, you may want to come and bail him out." Those days, I believe, are over. What does that have to do with math and your work? Not a darn thing, but I have a captive audience here. I want to encourage you to stay balanced in your life so that you can do the good work to train teachers, train staff members to embrace best practice in early math instruction. Because the lives you touch today are impacting the future. You're the, in my estimation, early literacy, early math, you're the last best hope for this country. I've been all over the world. The United States is still the best place to be, the best place to live. I know that. We built an orphanage in Nepal and one in Myanmar. We have to wade through mud knee-deep to get to the orphanage. And I'm thinking, I've got an iPhone. I've got all these amenities. So much to be thankful for. And guess what? The creativity, all of science is figured out through math. We understand phenomenon through math. We explain phenomena through math. So we need it. So all in all, thank you for your service to your ISD, to your local districts. You're really, really important people. If I can personally be of help to you in any fashion, support you in your work, your daily work, or in your ISD, or in your local, call on me. I will make the trip. That I promise. I give you my word. Thank you, and God bless you. We appreciate you so much.
And we've arrived. It is 3 o'clock. There's no better way to end than the way Paul ended. We talked about things that bring us joy in connection with what Paul just shared, and we thought the evaluation probably wasn't one of those things. So we're going to close now. We hope that you go forth with gratitude. We appreciate each and every one of you. Stay connected. We'll be connected soon on upcoming things. Safe travels back home and a great start to the school year.
On the slide with all the names, there's a list of people who have received a prize we drew randomly. If we could pull that up, what number? Slide 38. Oh, did you? No, it's right there. Okay. Oh, yeah, slide 38. And then once we get that up and you see your names, there'll be one more spinner drawing for a grand prize. So if you see your name on the back or up there, you're going to take a prize from the table in the back. Thank you, Paul, for bringing those. And then also, if we can spin the spinner, there's a grand prize from Cherry Republic. Can we spin that? Maybe? Oh, here we go. It looks like a Cheryl. Take that. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you, Paul, for the generous gifts.